You know, and that's one of the things about anti-aging. You know, it's interesting that the Japanese farmers, they'll come over to Hawaii, and they're in their 60s, and they'll take on a young bride, 20 or 30 years old. They'll have a child. They know they're in good health because they're eating a plant-based whole foods diet. They're exercising in the field. And they're going to live to when their child's is 20, 30, and they're 80, 90, but they're in good shape. You know, in our culture, Western world, it doesn't always support physical activity and healthy eating, and they use herbal medicine in Okinawa. I mean, it's one of the blue zones, right? One of the longest lived people. Right, so we can learn from those other cultures.
I bet they don't have trust funds over there either. Maybe that's why their kids hang on for a long time.
They all end up under one roof and hang out and learn from the elders.
Yeah, I suppose that's true.
Maybe the elders are good storytellers, and maybe they don't have Alzheimer's, so that at least they can appreciate jokes and have a good time.
Yeah.
You know, in our culture, multiple strokes, clogged arteries, you know, dementia, I mean, it's just rampant. So that's another point, mental acuity. Hormones affect mental acuity.
Yeah, we're living longer, but I'm not sure we're living better.
Yeah, because another thing in the Asian cultures, they have a 100-year-old has better testosterone, estrogen, DHA levels than a person 70 years old in our culture. 30 years difference, yet their hormones are optimized, at least relative to, maybe not to a 20-year-old, but compared to a 70-year-old, they have nearly much more effective or balanced hormone levels at higher levels. Activity, good diet, again, maybe a little less stress. Hard to say.
Yeah, hard to say.
Yeah.
Yeah. They chose their parents carefully, maybe. Yeah.
Well, you know what, though? When they migrate, the Japanese migrate from Hawaii, then get to the U.S., the rate of heart disease goes up 10 times.
Oh, of course, right.
Cancer goes up. So, you know, I when you're mentioning going, you know, the genetics, the same family goes to the same refrigerator and learns from the same TV commercials. So I think we need to look a little more closely at epidemiology and look at then migration of populations, and we've been doing that. Studies and quite a bit of work on that.
There's probably a correlation between the access to Burger King and McDonald's in longevity, I'm guessing.
Yeah, I mean, I know you've traveled around the world. I mean, you go to a country like Japan, and then there's McDonald's, and there's a line of people, and the line of people in that line are overweight and fat, and you go to their traditional Asian food, you know, and rice and vegetables and sweet potatoes, and they're fit and they're not overweight, you know, right?
Diet
affects hormones too.
Yes,
right?
It does. Absolutely, it all works together.
And that's why
the whole treatment process has to be done in that sort of gestalt kind of way. Got to do it all.
And I'm fascinated that you made a comment that in the near future, certain hormones that we normally ascribe to male hormones might become more important in female hormone replacement. I mean, just looking at the spectrum, I know one of my colleagues said, well, testosterone is important for women. It's often overlooked. Is there a place where women need a little bit of testosterone to assist in their well-being?
This is only my opinion, of course, which got a fair amount of history behind it. I think we have done women a disservice for many years by not recognizing testosterone deficiency early on, because generally speaking, we don't start testing women's hormones until the perimenopause. Mm-hmm. But I see a lot of younger women for various reasons, and we test them, and it's amazing, but it's rare to see a woman 35 years old with normal testosterone levels.
They're deficient, they're low.
Yeah, they're low. And why is it important for women? It's the same reason for men. It has to do with energy and strength and performance, sex drive, mood, sexual performance, orgasm, all that stuff is very important. And with women who are testosterone deficient are going to have poor quality life in those areas because of that.
Dr. Bedecs, could it be that also cellulite, is there any relationship to hormones or testosterone? Have you seen anything in the literature, or have you seen clinically any improvements in the skin and the outcome of?
Because I have, I also am involved with a fairly large cosmetic aesthetic practice, so we do a lot of work with collagen, because it's really the aging face is about collagen.
Right.
And collagen is formed by a number of reasons. Estrogen is an important part of that. Testosterone, growth hormone, all of these are important factors in the aging skin. So, cellulite If anybody can cure cellulite, they're going to make stashes for that person all over the free world. We don't understand that, but it has to do with fat distribution and laying down fat that we're not really sure about.
Yeah, I've had two female physicians who work in anti-aging say that they've seen some good results using maybe dosages slightly different than you would normally expect, but seem to improve the condition of cellulite.
Well, you can. But again, it's one of those things where it's diet and it's weight management and it's a whole bunch of other things involved.
Right.
Yeah.
Should women be concerned about hormone replacement and growing excess facial hair or anything on that order? Or if they had a tendency when they were younger, would it kind of reoccur? Is there ways to adjust for that with how you balance your hormones?
Oh, sure. I mean, you have to take all those things into consideration. Testosterone in women, yes, if in too large a dose, can increase some hair growth. It could increase clitoral size, which most women don't find all that offensive anyway. But
right.
But acne is a possibility. But you and I both know DHEA, given in too strong a dose, can cause acne in women. So it all has to be. It all has to be balanced, and for those people who know how to balance hormones, we all do it the same, pretty much. You start very low, and you work it up based on people's needs.
Yeah.
By doing it that way, you mitigate a lot some of the undesirable effects of hormone replacement.
I think in some of the early days, some of the practitioners were starting with higher dosages to get the patient a noticeable, dramatic result. But it didn't work out all that well. It's probably from the old bodybuilding, you know, era where they, you know, using mega dosages, and then they were just trying to translate. Well, if they took this, maybe we take this dose. But now we've learned. I mean, and also the European literature supports what you're talking about, starting low and, you know, getting to the point where they're getting a quality of life that you want, right?
Yeah, but you know, it's still, we have got a long ways to go because the men, for a good example is men and testosterone.
Okay.
I frequently will have my male patients come in and they'll tell me, yes, my doctor tested me for testosterone and I'm in the normal range. And you know something? They probably are. But it's not about the normal range. The normal range of testosterone is huge. Many of the labs, 250 to 1100, that's a large spread.
Right.
So if you're 275, are you in the normal range? Sure. Optimal range? Not even close.
Right.
So the same thing with women's hormones, the same thing. It's a big difference between normal and optimal. And that's one of the major differences probably with the kind of medicine that's practiced by guys like men and women like me, and you.
And Dr. Bedecs, I have a question. Dr. Eugene Shippen, who wrote Testosterone Syndrome, he once stated that the range certainly is certainly not correct, but maybe someone who was athletic, like an alpha male, they like and they're accustomed to and used to a level that might be 900 or 1,000 or 1,200, somewhere in there, or maybe even a little above. I know my son, when he was in his, just starting, you know, 19, 20, his levels were like 1,500. And, you know, he's a big bull of a man, very aggressive, very tough, and yet maybe a computer type guy who's just kind of just, you know, a little bit more cerebral and everything, his testosterone might have been during his, you know, youthful periods of age 20 to 28. It could have been only, you know, 700, 800, 600. But 600, 700 for a guy who's used to kind of being leading the pack and dominant and aggressive, he'd feel awful. But then the guy who's that cerebral guy put his up to 1,200 to 1,500 or above. He doesn't feel right either. Maybe it's just more than he needs. So is there, or could it be that guy who's kind of a little cerebral maybe missed out and something was not producing the way, or maybe it was the genetics, right? So what is the answer? What do you
think?
The
chicken and the egg.
Yeah,
the chicken and the egg. That's going to be a tough one to answer, but yes, everyone's doses are different and everyone's needs are different.
Right.
But the important thing to realize with men and testosterone, and I say this to all my men, that if testosterone was only about your biceps and your penis, it would still be a fabulous story. But the one organ of the human body that has more testosterone receptors in need than any place else is your heart.
Your heart.
It's a muscle. Yes. So, you know, when we start looking at testosterone replacement, yes, you get drive and energy and sex and muscle, but you also change your mental acuity, and you change your focus on family and job, and all kind of cool stuff happens mm-hmm. beyond all that. So I'm not sure with that. You know, I don't know if it's dose related in that way or not. So. Mm-hmm.
Well, and there's probably some discussion if a man comes into you and you're doing optimizing their hormone levels, but the female hasn't come in to see you, and all of a sudden the man's getting this rejuvenation. He's feeling, ooh, again like a 24-year-old buck.
We've got problems.
There's going to be some issues. So it's really important for the audience to know. I mean, you both reach a certain age, unless she's 22 and you're, you know, 62, and then you're trying to catch up to her, which sometimes happens, but sometimes it's the other way now. Sometimes the lady's, you know, 52 and the guy's, you know, 31,
it's
right?
It's a funny old world out there, Nick.
It's changed since our days and since our parents' days. Yeah, it'll continue to change. But we want to be part of the change in a way. I mean, to kind of at least help people to, you know, find where their niche is, what's best for them, right?
Oh, absolutely. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. There's a large picture here to consider.